that I haven't met yet. I'm the alderman here in Ward 6.
Yeah.
Do I go meet his mic? All right. You're recording this at my request. That's true, so I should do this. Hi, everyone. I'm Lance Davis. I'm the alderman here in Ward 6. I want to say one thing real quick, because it's related to this, but not specifically related to this. There's a lot of things happening in Davis Square, and it's great that we're having these sessions so we can really, you know, get our vision as a community onto paper and work towards that over the next 20 years. But there are things that are happening right now, and things that haven't been happening over the last, you know, well, forever. But you know, the market that just opened this week is a great example of what happens when the community comes together and says, we don't want this, we want this, you know, this would be great, and it seems like a pipe dream, but we now have a really cool market right in the square that is, I think, is a great addition. So your participation in these types of events and even just the neighborhood meetings about a certain proposal can absolutely make a difference. So thank you for coming out to this. Tell your friends that and preach that as well, because the more people we get, you know, weighing in and giving their opinions on things, you know, the better we have a sense of what the community is looking for, and to the extent that we can work to that, that's kind of the whole point. So that's all I'll say. I'll get out of the way. I'll hang out a bit afterwards if anyone wants to ask me about anything specific. All right.
So thank you all for coming tonight. We're in the middle of a five meeting stretch. The first one, we talked about place types and the history and future development in Davis Square. How many people were able to make it to that first meeting? Great, okay. And hopefully some of you saw that information online as well. But we can bring you up to speed tonight in our breakout sessions if need be, and we'll have a recap as well. Tonight we're talking about the scale of new developments, and then we'll later get into the aesthetics and design details of existing and possibly new buildings in the square, with the intention of developing design guidelines for Davis Square. Like I said, tonight we're going to talk about the scale of new developments. First, we're going to go over what happened at the last meeting, and I'm going to relay the feedback that you gave us. We're going to talk about new types of infill and building types associated with that, and then also how we see the city. Dan's going to get into some real nerd stuff, and that's really the only way I can describe it. And then lastly, we'll look at the boards more thoroughly in the back of the room. So last week, or a couple of weeks ago, we asked you what place type is Davis Square, and asked you questions about jobs and housing and what you'd like to see in the future. And I couldn't have said it any better than Alderman Davis, but you know, there's stuff that's happening in a 6-month interval and in a 20-year interval that we want to know what you want to see in the future of your square. And so we thought that Davis Square was a local center, but it kind of had a mix of a couple different place types. And so we asked you, what do you want Davis Square to be in the future? And 68% of you answered that you wanted Davis Square to be a local center. The remainder answered urban center or didn't answer at all. So when we asked which was more important to develop in the future, jobs or housing, when you could only pick one, the majority of people wanted more jobs than housing developed. And at which ratio was 3-1. I gave a little bit of a spiel setting up about how Summer Vision talks about a 5-1 ratio of jobs to housing. And the survey respondents, about 50 of you, thought the ratio should be at about 3 jobs to 1 housing unit. And then we get into what types of jobs do you want to see? The first being service, second being clerical administration, lab, research, and lastly, creative. And there was a healthy mix of everything. Creative definitely was slightly preferred other than the other categories, lab being slightly less than the others, but a good mix of employment types. And then I asked about the height of buildings. Do you want tall buildings? Do you want short buildings? Townhouses. And the majority of people picked the height of buildings in between 5 and 7 stories. So you'll see tonight there's not a 20-story building shown on any of these boards here. So what I want to transition to talking about is building types and what types of buildings we're going to see in infill development in Davis Square. Davis Square is currently a zoning district, and that means that it's in that zoning district, all the buildings are regulated with the same dimensions. But when we transition to a conversation about building types, it provides a nuance that there are many different types of buildings within the within Davis Square, and they all have different dimensional requirements. To remind you, we talked about the Davis Square neighborhood last time, but when we talk about building types tonight, we're talking about the Davis Square core, really Davis Square proper, the business district of Davis Square. So there's four building types that we want to talk to you guys about tonight. The first is the general building. A general building is any mix of uses. It could be a retail first floor, an office second floor, and housing on the third and fourth floors. It can really be any mix. It gets more pertinent when you talk about really tall buildings. You can imagine a building that's a hotel and also residential with a restaurant on the top floor that, you know, spins in circles so you get a good view or something. But general buildings can be of any size and are a mix of uses. The following three are just sort of riffs on the general building in which they get more specific about uses. The first is the apartment buildings. You'll see buildings in this presentation, some of which are in Davis Square, some of which are in Somerville, and some that are not from even New England. But apartment buildings are specific to an apartment use, so it's just residential within within the building. There's commercial buildings. Commercial buildings are all commercial. That doesn't mean that a retail first floor is a mix. It doesn't exclude retail on the first floor, and then you have office space above. It can be all office or different types of offices and commercial space within one building. And last is laboratory buildings. Laboratory buildings are commercial, but they're a specific use in which they're lab and research and development. So you can kind of start thinking of the context of maybe where you went to work today and what kind of building you might be working in, what sort of building type. And each building type has market-driven factors behind it. And I'm just going to touch on the very beginning of market-driven factors. The first in the residential buildings is a 60-foot depth. Residential buildings prefer a 60-foot depth because that's the most efficient way to get a double-loaded corridor. So you have residential units on each side and a shared corridor in the middle. They're also the lowest floor-to-floor, meaning that the ceiling heights are lower than a commercial building. This is one layout of two residential buildings side by side. This is also another idea of a residential building that's built off a central stairwell. These buildings are still being built in Somerville today. There's a couple new ones on Somerville Ave that the building's not quite tall enough to have an elevator, or the lot's not wide enough to have that long corridor, so it's a walk-up. Commercial buildings have totally different requirements. What's really important in commercial buildings is the depth to the core. You have about 40 feet to get from the exterior wall to the core. The core means where the elevators, where the bathrooms, where the mechanical spaces are that run through the building. And it's really important for daylight access and office layout for that 40-foot module to be present, and to have windows on all sides makes it really efficient. They also have a preferred floor plate size of about 25,000 square feet, and you want to give people enough window access and lighting to come in the building. The ceiling height is a little taller than a residential building, at about maybe 9 feet versus 8 feet for a residential building. So you can imagine how this adds up floor to floor to floor, because if you have 8 feet, then 9 feet, you know, you end up with a 5 foot taller building. Next, are laboratory basics. How many of you work in a lab building? So we have some people probably intimately familiar with this. A lab module is based on 10 feet 6 inches, and it can repeat ad nauseum. That's really the preference of research and development companies. And you can see a long row here. You either have sort of an open concept, depending on what kind of research and development is done there. You can have an open concept, which is what's shown on the top here, or if it's more private, more high security kind of research, the lab space is separate from the office space and sort of clerical staff. And lab buildings get to be the largest floor to floor. That's because they have a lot of guts. So there's the floor, and then there's the finished ceiling height in a laboratory or office building. But what's important in a lab building is how much stuff you can fit in that space between the ceiling and the floor above, because in the first picture on the upper left, you have just the building structure, a very vanilla. But once you add the mechanical ducts, the piping, and then the tell data and wiring, you need more floor to floor because of all the infrastructure that needs to go into a lab building to make it work. So you end up with a taller building. So it goes residential, then commercial, then lab, needing the biggest floor to floor at about 14 feet. This is another image of what a lab looks like. This has an open ceiling, but this is about 16 feet floor to floor. Labs also need a high amount of exhaust. There's different ways to exhaust it, but you'll see more mechanical equipment come off the roof or come through the roof. And that's something just to know about laboratory buildings and why they might look different than an office building. So what we want you to have this mindset about how buildings are going to be coming to Davis Square, how development could or could not change or contribute to Davis Square's character. Because just because we know maybe what a building's depth or height is going to be, we still don't really know what it's going to look like. And so part of the activity tonight is asking yourself about what makes a building contributing to Davis Square's character. Because if we want residential buildings, we can ask ourselves, is this the right context for a residential building? If the height matches a neighbor, does it mean it's in the right context? Does a window pattern match the existing context? This building has the same height, but different windows. Is that contributing to Davis Square's character? Another interesting window pattern. So the intention of these five meetings is to first inform zoning. You know, how tall is it? How big is it? And we can do that through building height, building type, height, and massing. And we're talking a lot about massing tonight. And then our intention over the next several meetings is starting to develop that character for informing the design guidelines of Davis Square. So next, I'm going to invite Dan Bartman up here. I told you he has a lot of nerd things to talk to you about, but some very interesting research that he's been working on.
Thank you, Melissa. I think one of the things we gloss over that we always take for granted is that the new version of the Somerville zoning ordinance that we've been working on for the past 5 years uses building types because of all of the nuances that are different across the different types of buildings. Because, for instance, today, a 50-foot height limit will have an impact on the ability for a lab building to come into Davis Square if somebody was interested in building a lab building and the community was willing to accept a lab building. You might have a lot of problems when a apartment building and a lab building and a commercial building are regulated the same when they have all these different characteristics that are innate to their own, how they're built. So the version of the ordinance that we're working on differentiates those different buildings from one another so that we can understand how to regulate them differently to ease the construction process. But today I want to talk to you primarily about these things related to, we discussed type, but height and massing is something that isn't related to how the facade of the building is designed. The topic that I want to get to is called environmental psychology. Has anybody heard of that before? Any hands? A couple, five maybe? So this is a subject our office has been getting into more and more recently. It was a field of research that came about since the 1960s. It examines people's perceptions and judgments of their environment. Its purpose is it also studies the processes of perception. So, you know, how we form opinions about what we're perceiving, but also the mechanics of how we perceive things in our environment. The whole inspiration for it was to solve problems between human and environmental interactions, right? And when I bring up the environment, I'm talking about the built environment in our case. And its primary concern is related to human well-being. It asks questions like, how do we perceive our surroundings? And does what we perceive cause positive, favorable, or pleasing responses or experiences? And their primary finding, their whole thesis for doing all of the research, and it's interdisciplinary, is that the environment affects people's physical and mental well-being, and that people make choices based on the aesthetic value of what they're looking at. And that's really important for figuring, and why we are holding a series of five meetings to try and understand David Square's character and what infill buildings need to do to blend in with that aesthetically. That's also why you're starting to see lots of articles hit the press. The subtitle underneath this is Boring Cityscapes Increase Sadness, Addiction, and Disease-Related Stress. Is urban design a matter of public health? Science is learning more and more that the environment that we live in is having an impact on all of these features. Tufts also has written recently and done a lot of research related to that. They're actually on the forefront of this type of science. So why is this useful for urban planning and urban design? Research that evaluates the aesthetic quality of environments studies the response of normal everyday users. A lot of us in the field like to think we know more than all of you, except that science is interested in how all of you who aren't forming biased opinions actually react to buildings, and so it studies non-experts. We can use it to inform public policy making so that we improve the emotional well-being of residents. That's one of the reasons that Somerville surveys resident happiness. Can you still hear me this far away?
Yes.
No, him. But that's one of the reasons that we survey resident happiness, is to get at well-being. And so a lot of what we do in our office is driven at improving the well-being of our residents. And this scientific research can survive the scrutiny of the courts. Recently, there was a couple of Supreme Court cases that decided what was acceptable scientific evidence, and it's not when a bunch of experts come into the room that agree with one another and just tell you that's how it should be. You actually have to back it up with science and data that's peer-reviewed and published in a journal. And so all of what we're talking about is based on journal research that we spent the time to read and order books and investigate. So environmental psychology can help inform the development of design guidelines and the design review process to make sure that buildings elicit a positive emotional response. What we're trying to get at is something that's objective instead of subjective, because design review ends up being a war about architectural style, and that's not really what the purpose is. There are underlying principles related to buildings that have nothing to do with style, right? And so we want to provide an objective analysis of whether or not buildings contribute to our well-being and still allow people to produce beautiful buildings that are not all the same, that are not necessarily traditional or contemporary or modern. And the reason is that we haven't been delivering buildings that make us feel better, because the normal reaction to infill is to say no, right? This is a quote from a professor from Ohio State. If the people altering and delivering buildings produce pleasing results for the public, our society would not have opted for design guidelines and peer review, but this exists in almost every city. And that's why it's important for us to do this kind of work. Research has identified three characteristics that humans perceive relevant to the having an aesthetic response, or buildings inducing an aesthetic response in us as we experience the built environment. The first one is enclosure. Enclosure is really about how buildings define space in between each other. They can either be widely open or really narrow. And it turns out that we kind of like somewhere in between. We don't like too wide open because we feel vulnerable, and we don't like too close together because we feel claustrophobic. So we want somewhere in between. This means that enclosure is really spatial definition. Everyone follow? So it turns out that there's an area of the brain called the parahippocampal place area at the base of our brain, right behind where our optic nerve attaches to the underside of the brain. And if you show somebody, if you put them in an MRI machine and you show them a room or a cityscape, that area of the brain lights up. And if you remove the room and leave behind the furniture, or if you remove the cityscape and leave behind the cars and the signs and everything, that part of the brain shuts off. There's a specific part of the brain designed for us to sense space. And that's why it's really important to understand how these buildings that we're illustrating here today shape space, and so that we can all make judgments related to that. Urban planners and urban designers have been writing about this for decades. This is a famous book called The Concise Townscape by Gordon Cullen. He really said that outdoor or enclosure to create an outdoor room is perhaps the most powerful, the most obvious of all devices to instill a sense of position, identity within your surroundings, because it embodies the idea of here-ness. You're going to see all these quotes build up on one another. Christopher Alexander, his pretty famous book, The Pattern Language, it's like 600 pages long. outdoor space is positive when it has a distinct and definite shape, as definite as the shape of a room, and when its shape is as important as the shapes of the buildings which surround it. Alan Jacobs wrote a really famous book about streets and the buildings that surround them. And he wrote specifically that we need buildings to define or even enclose space rather than sit and be objects within space. Right? The buildings shape space. People react favorably to fixed boundaries as something safe, defined, and even memorable. It's because our brains are hardwired to realize that we're within it. This even goes all the way back to the 1800s. Camillo Sitte is probably the inspiration for all of these other planners. This is somebody that we reference frequently. But the number one thing that he writes about in his book, the most important quality of our public realm is its sense of enclosure. That the enclosure of space in its purest expression causes a sense of place. Right? That's really what we care about in Davis Square. Why we're doing all of this work is we want to maintain its sense of place while all of these buildings get built. But he warned us that the relationship between buildings and plazas cannot be established as definite as, for instance, the relationship between columns and entablatures as defined in handbooks. Does anybody know what he's talking about? No. Any classical architects in the room?
What's entablature?
It's what's on top of a... Yeah. Do you want to...
Oh, no, it's just there are a set of ratios for, you know, the width of your column to the height of your column and to the height... Well, you can extrapolate it up, but going back to the classical forms of Greek architecture, there are these canonical relationships.
So if you build a Greek temple that's 1 inch high and a Greek temple that's 30 stories high, it'll have the exact same proportion because that's how they built and designed their architecture. And that's what he's talking about. Because human beings are involved and it's subjective, there's a range that we're talking about. And the range isn't going to be the same for everybody. And sometimes you're going to feel good about space, maybe based on your mood at the time, and sometimes you might feel differently at a different period of time. That kind of creates this graphic. This is kind of a Rosetta Stone of spatial definition that you'll see in any planning book, right? We've all of us in the back of the room have seen this diagram. But it tries to set up ratios that people find acceptable, right? And there's a couple different ways to actually shape space. It can be based off of the buildings in this middle here over on the right. You can do it with trees. Trees can shape space. And you can even use a step back to try and recess the top half of a building and then make only the bottom part be sensed by our vision. And that's one of the things you're going to see tonight. So they kind of bring up all these different ratios from the text and the literature of all these urban planners that are suggesting ratios that are that we find acceptable, and they say that 6:1 is the perceived maximum, and the 3:1 perceived maximum of how far apart the buildings could be and how tall they are to make us feel like we're inside, right? And that 3:1 is once we start feeling dominated. And that's why in a lot of places where you see old world streets in European cities, they're actually only three or four stories tall, and one of the reasons that we still find them to be charming and not overpowering is because they kind of follow this relationship. And that's where a lot of people, the writers that developed these ratios, went out and measured things in cities that people found to be ideal, and that's where these relationships come from. So I wanted to show you this in Davis Square, because we can see where these ratios are on some of the streets here. So this is on Elm Street, and all of the streets in Davis Square are pretty much 60 feet wide. This is from facade to facade, so you're including the sidewalk. This one happens to be, on this side, is about a 1:2 relationship, and this is 1:3 on this side. This is a little bit shorter, right? So this goes in about three times. This is just further down the street. I'm just zooming in in the photo, right? So you're moving down the street, and the relationship changes. It goes from almost a balance, right, to this side being way more enclosed than this side of the street. This is about 1 to 2 on this side. This is about 1 to 4. And then back down the street again where the new store just opened up, it totally switches sides. The enclosure switches from one side of the street to the next and is a little bit lower than this example. You can even flip over to Holland or Highland Street.
Highland Ave?
Yes. Yeah. and this four-story building is almost exactly the same height. It's a little bit shallow. It'd probably land about right there. And then further down, you know, that's only one block. We're like right up here. And spatial definition almost goes completely away. If you jump into the main intersection, this is 165 feet. On this side of the street, this is a relationship of 1 to 8 and about 1 to 4.5 over here. And if you look at this from an aerial, you can actually see how little, you know, these are long lines and the buildings aren't that tall. And in many places, the main square is actually barely holding on to what we would recognize as defined space. Now, you know, there's a couple four-story buildings on this side. You might only have to put 1 or 2 floors on this and all of a sudden it would register, right? Can anybody think of a area of the square, main square, that is really well spatially defined?
The one surrounded by trees?
Yeah. The main plaza is the most spatially defined place in the square and probably the most beloved, right? Because we feel inside. It's not fully enclosed. We're not trapped inside, but we feel protected inside that space. So the problem with these ratios, though, is that using Davis Square's 60-foot wide street, that means that a one-story building can frame it in the bottom scenario, and 15 to 17 stories could frame it in the uppermost. That's not a lot of guidance for how tall Davis Square should be, right? The middle ground is a 1-to-1 relationship. So you can think about 60 feet as kind of a sweet spot for how tall buildings could maybe be in Davis Square. And there's the examples that I just gave, there's lots of opportunity for a couple more floors that we wouldn't feel in general, and this is, you know, the law of averages, that most people would say is not too dominating of a spatial definition. And that's one of the reasons that we went into, you know, what kind of place type do you want to be? Because different places have different levels of enclosure. And so we wanted to ask that question before we ever got into the subjective question of should we be one story or 17, right? We needed some more guidance. So that was enclosure, right? Which is primarily spatial definition, as I said. The second thing is complexity. And I'm gonna go over one feature about complexity in detail, but the next two things that you see, complexity being one of them, we're gonna spend a lot of time in our third and fourth meeting going over those things. So I'm gonna not spend a lot of time on them. Recent psychological research shows that humans prefer ambiguous but complex patterns in their visual fields, and that this seems to be a fundamental perceptual preference, even applying to infants. They've been testing what babies are seeing, and they're reacting the exact same way as adults, right? We're looking for interesting environments, stimulating environments. The overall finding in this area is that there's an optimal range of perceptual input for our brains. Preferred by most subjects, that both too simple and too chaotically complex is disliked, right? So just like spatial definition, we like to have stimulus in our way that our facades are designed, and you know, the number of trees, the detail of the shop fronts, the amount of people that are walking around, those are all stimulus inputs. The brain wants about 1,000 stimulations per hour, which is about 1 every 4 seconds, to not be bored, right? And you'll hear a lot of people talk about why the 30-foot shop front is an important feature of urban design. And that's because if an average person walking down a sidewalk passes a 30-foot shop front every 4 seconds. So that kind of street rhythm keeps you interested as you walk. That's also why we find some facades boring and others interesting, because of that rhythm, because it's stimulating to our brains. For buildings, 3 features related to complexity can be independently studied by science, right? These are silhouette. This is the outline of the building and primarily the roof. So if you look at pitched roofs that are from different architectural periods, you have Victorian you know, that are really steep and rise really high compared to the pitch roofs that we build today, or a Gothic roof that has all kind of spinnerets and things going on. That's a more complex silhouette in our visual field. The second thing is massing, which we're going to spend a ton of time on today, and we're going to judge on all of these panels, is related to the bulk of the building. And the details are really about the windows, and is there a cornice, and what color is it painted, what texture is it made out of in the design of a facade. And those are the three primary features that we can test and understand scientifically related to the amount of complexity that we experience in our environment. And the last one is order, and it also has three things related to the patterns that we see within a building and between buildings, and whether or not the details of a building are repeated on another one, right? That would institute a sense of order in the environment. And the third thing is whether or not we can see ourselves in the building and using the building and understand what the building's for because of the patterns. We recognize how it's used by humans. And the last word, tectonics, relates to understanding how the building's built and why it's a safe building to be in. And this is kind of the summation of what the literature says about the design of buildings and what can be regulated, I guess, and defensible in court. And none of these have to do with architectural style. Like I said, I'm going to talk about most of these during meeting three and four. We're going to have a bunch of exercises where we're going through details and debating, you know, the materials that we are interested in seeing infill buildings be built with and things like that. But I wanted to focus more about the massing of buildings today because that's the exercise that we're going to go through. This is literally just the physical bulk of the building and how it might be shaped. Research has found that the visual area of a building, how much it occupies of our visual field, explains 77% of the variance when people were asked what's their impression of a building's mass, right? So that's a lot. They tested fenestration, they tested cornices, and it turned out that it's just related to how much it occupies. The question is, there are techniques to reduce the size of a building in our visual field, and the environmental psychology research has done a lot of work to try and understand how much of these or what features reduce the bulk of a building. And that's by dividing the bulk up into multiple things, setting a portion of the bulk back from the front lot line, and stepping upper portions of the building further back. And you remember that was in the diagram of spatial enclosure, right? All of our exercises today are based off of these three things and judging their impact on different heights of buildings. So I have blow-ups of what you're going to see on all of these boards here. This is just a normal building, right? It's has none of the techniques to try and adjust its mass, and all of us might find it acceptable, or none of us might. Some of us might, right? There's examples of this all throughout Davis Square. Actually, most of the buildings are designed to just be straight up to some degree. There's detailing on the facades, but they're pretty much square, right? The second thing is that you can adjust the step back. This is just the upper floor is stepped back. This might be perceived by others to be just a four-story building. And you're going to see this in perspective on a lot of the boards. This is the proposal for Johnny D's. You can see it included a step back because it's got a fourth floor penthouse on the top, but it was designed to try and continue the street wall at three stories. The Citizens Bank building has some step backs. When you're on the street, this kind of reads as a three-story building when you're walking along that same sidewalk. And this top portion kind of blends off into the background for some people. And this is a building on Mass Ave. The second intervention, these might be in different order on the boards, is to actually divide the mass up into two buildings or to construct it and design it in a way that it simulates that effect. I was talking about this with somebody earlier. These are two buildings in different places in the country where somebody's made a lot of effort to try and make this building look smaller than it actually is. This top one here is the same building from different sides. Can you tell me how many of these, anybody tell me how many of these shop fronts are all one building? Anyone? All of them, right? All of this is all one building straight across. These are all floors that are continuous. There's probably a double-loaded corridor in there like Melissa was talking about earlier. How about the bottom example? Any guess?
Six.
Just the end here.
Oh.
This is actually...
I was counting all of it. Okay.
This is actually in New Haven.
Okay.
So this is an example we could all drive to and look at. This is probably better architecture for New England than in Sarasota, Florida. But you can see that this is possible. There are construction inefficiencies by having somebody make their site two buildings instead of one building. You need more stairwells, for example. Each building has to have two means of egress by building code. So if you build two buildings, each one has to have two stairwells. That's four stairwells where you could have maybe just built two if it was all one building. And that's why sometimes people emulate smaller shop fronts, even though this might all be one building. The last thing is to set back a portion of the building. And you can see some examples from around the country here. These are both in Boston. This is in Southie. This is near Fenway, where they're actually setting back portions of the facade so that this reads as multiple buildings marching down the street. This is a building actually built over a bridge in Ohio. And this is like the entry area for this building. And that's the only portion that's set back. This part is repeated on this side, on the other side. And this mass is actually part of this building here. This was all built at the same time, and they set back this portion to look like another building. But these are three different ways that you can adjust mass from all one shape to try and make it appear smaller in our visual field. And that's why we're having you go through this exercise today, to help us understand, are buildings too long? Are they too tall? And if so, are there techniques that we could use to maybe get that same floor but make it blend in better? And we're interested in having all your opinion for all of that. I told somebody I didn't think this was gonna take long, so we're already at our activity, which is the last part for tonight.
I'm sorry I came late, but I was wondering, in terms of not just aesthetic pleasantness of the building itself, but what is the effect on walking sunlight, making the whole area look darker?
Mm-hmm. That's one of the considerations. Spatial definition has an impact on sky views. One of the things that they bring up why a 1-to-1 ratio is considered to be the sweet spot is because when there's the same amount of building as sky plane in our visual field, I can see sky for the same amount of height. So the human eyeball sees about it in a 27-degree cone. And then the rest of it is blurry. That's our peripheral vision. And in that cone, if you have half of that as a building and half of it as sky, it's thought to be the sweet spot. And above 1-to-1 ratio, you would start having building creep up into that. And that's where you start feeling like you're completely inside space without seeing any sky. The other consideration that we want you to think about is, you know, is the location where this building is, would this height maybe block sunlight from ground view? And that's a valid concern to have. And is one of the things that would have an impact on how the environment impacts our well-being. So it's definitely something we want you to think about while you're going around. But know that 60 feet is still within that sweet spot, and that's about a 5-story building.
It seems weird because when you walk past Harvard Vanguard on Cullen, seems to be so much less sunlight.
Mm-hmm.
Then you just walk a little bit further, and it's just a totally different feeling to the street.
What are the general rules of thumb that we use when we're trying to identify sites that might be viable for a new building or a replacement building is a 4-to-1 ratio that we say if this building's a 1-story building, somebody would build economically. They would look to build a 4-story building because there's just not the profit to tear down and replace a building that if you can't get four times the amount that's already there, you might as well just keep running that for the effort that it takes to do that. And so that means that a lot of your buildings that are in Davis Square are going to stay in Davis Square for a long time because they're already those variable heights. So that's something to remember is that we're not talking about the uniform replacement of all buildings in Davis Square. So some of the places where there is more sunlight, for instance, at a 2-story or 3-story building, it'll be there for many, many years to come. Even if we build one new four-story building in another location.
Can I ask, because you said we're going to do this exercise, and I walked around and looked at the posters, are we operating on the assumption that there will be new construction in each of the addresses that are on these posters, and do we have any other sort of given facts about that? Like, it will be at least this height, or...
So we picked 4 to 6 stories because the input we got from the first meeting said a local center, which is pegged in to be mid-rise construction. And we picked 4 stories because the replacement ratio needs to reach out to that height, especially if some of these are one-story buildings or parking lots. We did pick a bunch of parking lots. There wasn't anything specific informing our site selection aside from this is more probable than a 3-story building that's got a bunch of good uses in it. Like the building with J.P. Licks on the plaza isn't going to get torn down anytime soon.
It's not one of the posters. So I guess
right.
What I'm trying to ask is, will there be new construction of some sort on each of these locations? Is that a given?
No. Okay. No, not at all. Okay. These are more representations of a more probable site than others, and that's why we picked them to illustrate the exercise.
Yeah. One thing I noticed from looking around was, maybe I'm misinterpreting it, but when I looked at all of the possible replacement buildings, they all look like really boring rectangular boxes, even if they are divided or set back in some way.
Yeah.
they're basically, they have no architecture. Is that something we should be ignoring? It's hard. I can't see any of those buildings looking good in those shapes because they all look like boring boxes, even if you applied these treatments to them.
Yeah. The real focus tonight is to try and understand. There's some questions at the very end that might tee this up better, and that's one of the reasons we made this board so you could, like, if you weren't certain, you could come and look at the board and see the effect that a step back has, a setback has.
Like, for instance, the second one there has a peaked roof.
Right.
None
of those have a peaked roof. Right, because that's one of the categories of adding complexity,
okay.
And we're going to get into those in the next 2 meetings.
Okay.
Can you tell us something about the character and quality of the developers who will be building here? These things will be developed by somebody who owns a building, like John and Pete wants to develop it. They're, enormous real estate developing companies that here, David Square, I'll go there and make a bundle and get on to the next one and wreck the next place. Tell us about the kinds of people you're dealing
with. Well, I totally empathize with the concern. Two things. We haven't made any hypothetical opinions about the developers that might build these hypothetical buildings, because what we're trying to understand is how much mass in that site is too dominating, in your opinion. The second thing is, by doing this work and developing design guidelines that our design review committee and planning board or ZBA would hold a developer accountable to, you're influencing the aesthetic quality and of their product. At this moment, you're informing that, and that it's something that's important to be a part of now, because without them, a lot of the undesirable or missed opportunities that we see happening with development that lets people down and you end up with all the no's is because we actually don't have any design guidelines right now. That's it. Nobody's developed design guidelines for Davis Square to inform what the quality level of the end product should be today.
Is there research on the effect of how uniform a cityscape is?
Yep.
In some of the earlier slides that you were showing, when you were saying the heights are shifting and it's sometimes enclosed and sometimes not enclosed, and it goes from one side of the street to the other. To me, that's one of the appealing things about walking around Davis Square. But from a planning point of view, maybe that's not appealing, but from sort of a quality of life,
right,
it makes it much more interesting. So, in addition to how massing and height and all that other stuff, I know some of this would overlap with, say, design of the building, perhaps, but there must be some research on how important that is to the perceived or sense of well-being.
The environmental psychology research has done a lot of work about endless repetition, actually contributing to boredom, because it's not a stimulation anymore to the brain. It accepts that it's there repeatedly and starts ignoring it. And so the, you know, forcing the hand of somebody to do the exact same thing isn't really the desired outcome. That's also more in meeting three and four. I know it's hard to not get to the facade of the building because it's impactful, but if you go to places like a lot of DC has streets that are all built to this to the same height, others might find that same characteristic to be better or more favorable than the variation in the height limit. But I can tell you, in the work that we do, we actually don't like uniform height limits for all different types of buildings, because it actually provides, when infill does happen, it ends up being all at the same height. And what you want is a little bit of variation to add complexity and richness and differences. And even if all the floors of the buildings are the same, when people construct buildings, they make decisions on their own to build each floor 3 inches different. And the, you know, all those all that adds up. Or they decide to put, you know, a different roof element on, and all of that adds to the visual richness of the building. But there are places in the country that have had uniform development happen under a uniform height limit, and it ends up being one of the most boring things that contributes to that. But that's true. Yeah, that impacts the how wind gets funneled through streets too.
Let's take two more questions, and then we'll move on to the activity. I saw two. This gentleman in blue and gold, and we will be happy to address any questions in the breakout. Thank you.
Is there a time over the next few sessions, Dan, when we'll be talking about how the street level use affects our experience of the mass of the building?
Yes, that'll come up. That comes up a lot related to meeting three and four, and the design and aesthetics of all floors of the building come up, but the first floor is absolutely 90% of the importance in all, how all of that happens, because that's the part of the building that we interact with the most. Was it the blue?
Yeah, so my question is about proceeding with the assumption that 4 to 5 stories is the right building height based on the first meeting. I feel like during the first meeting, all we talked about was kind of conceptions of neighborhood character, but didn't discuss any of the other trade-offs related to building height, like how much affordable housing can be developed in Davis Square, and, you know, will people be able to afford to continue to live here to enjoy the environmental, psychological benefits of
right.
the design?
So one, I think one of the things to keep in mind is that I was kind of joking around with somebody earlier, you know, is this one of the options? Can you just put a dot on where we're at today? And you can, right? But you won't get any affordable housing. You won't get any more jobs unless you are willing to accept some new construction in the neighborhood, and the neighborhood will never stay the same, right? What Melissa and I are able to do, and this, but it's going to be based on information generated today, is that we know the square footage of each of these sites, and we'll know not a consensus, but a direction everybody's heading with how much building they think is appropriate for each site. That's, we can generically convert that into square footage and figure out, you know, how much housing could be contributed in that square footage, how many jobs per square foot of commercial floor area would be created on different sites. That's where we're going toward in the plan. We laid that out a lot in a lot of detail in the Union Square plan. It takes a long time to get there, and we're in the very first steps of just figuring out that long road, and this will lead us in that direction.
Yeah, and I guess my concern is that, you know, something might, I might see and say, oh, this one looks the nicest.
Yeah.
But if another alternative that I didn't think looked quite as nice is able to accommodate a development that's going to create affordable housing and allow families to be able to stay in Somerville, then, you know, I would have liked to have known that before saying, oh, let's move along with this
right.
lower square footage option.
I agree with him. I had a meeting way back whenever, and people made those decisions. I know that the community was invited to come to these, but I don't remember anybody saying come and decide the height of the buildings. I mean, because it sounds to me they're too high and not affordable housing.
So,
and I also don't understand what's the plan. You're going to tear down the square and put these up?
Most of the sites here that you see tonight are parking lots or sites where we've talked with people about improving the site some point in the future or not. Somebody is interested in a lot and says, you know, I have an employer looking for a site on the Red Line. Davis Square is the only Red Line access that Somerville has. And they say, they come to us and say, we've been looking at this site, we've been looking at that site, what could we build here? And that's why we're coming to you first, so that you help inform the decision about what, when an interest shows up, you can make that trade-off question known to them beforehand. And we might all inform that conversation and decide, you know what, we need to build affordable housing here, or we need to build commercial buildings, because there's only a couple sites available for commercial buildings, so that we can get the job goal met that we're looking for. Whether or not a building is commercial or residential is a secondary question to whether or not the building's too tall or too long or too massive and domineering for that street, though. The use of a building can fluctuate within those height limits. We're not talking about the 20-story podium tower that is being discussed for Union Square. So there's the amount of variation here is smaller. But we're going to have those conversations.
This isn't a question, can I just add a data point to you before
sure.
we do this? There are about 250 businesses in Davis Square on the first floor. You walk around and count them up. That's how many there are. There's 250 businesses on the first floor of Davis Square, different businesses. Close to 100 of those are small, in one and two-story buildings, and they're the kind of businesses that probably wouldn't be able to afford the rent of a larger building. So when you think about the massing of a building and thinking that it might be a good idea to build the square up with, you know, higher volume buildings, that could be fine from an urban perspective, but you also have to think of what that's going to do to the ground floor world that you like, and you only like part of it. Everybody likes part of it. But those are considerations that have to be, I think, put into deciding about these massing questions, because they're not. This isn't just an independent exercise that comes back and gets used in the form of a percentage. You know, X percentage like this and X percentage like that.
Let me point at some of the questions. So obviously, these are all these sites are within the core area that we've talked about with Davis. We're not talking about anything within the residential areas of the neighborhood, and we picked. You know, these are two parking lots. This is a city-owned parking lot. We've talked about development in the past. This is what inspired the whole conversation here with this lot. You know, this lot was purchased recently and is going through a lot of, that's altitude, is going through a lot of changes today. And one of the reasons that we thought including it would be important, this purple one all the way to the right.
Yeah, it's behind the laundromat and the Paul's Auto shop.
Includes the laundromat?
And the rented
yes.
Gallery.
Okay. Little known secret is that the MBTA built this head house so that it could be a three-story building, and today it's just a shed building. We
both
went.
Sides or just that side? Both
sides? No, not both sides. Not both sides. This was an agreement between multiple people, including the city, that we needed this built so that it could one day have a building on top of it. They didn't build that building, but they did build the foundations underneath it to be able to handle that on top. That's why we've always included it. It's kind of a small site, so we included the corner here and then said, well, this is one of the biggest areas of Davis and the lowest building holding spatial definition. So we included it for the sake of the exercise. There's nobody talking with us today about, you know, taking out the banks.
Can you clarify first which of the sites actually are currently available for development at this very time then?
All of Davis Square is available for development. Like the private market is continually working, and sometimes it's a property owner's decision like Carla at Johnny D's, and other times it's more market driven and done through a developer, more speculative, that builds a building and then says, hey tenant, come here. So all these sites are theoretically available for development, but they were selected because of that ratio of likelihood, but that does not mean that something is going to happen tomorrow.
Right, I mean, I guess that's the question I'm asking. It's not just theoretically available, but actually available today.
None of them are for sale.
Okay.
The ones that are owned
by the city. Oh, yeah,
are the parking lots on Day Street and the parking lot at Rite Aid?
Right. This is this parking lot right here, but not Rite Aid, is owned by the city. This parking lot's owned by the city. This is the parking for this One Davis Square. So if any building was going to go there, they'd have to figure out something with the parking, right? So there are factors in the way of all of these sites. And I can tell you, the city has learned its lesson about advancing development proposals before talking with anybody. That's one of the reasons that we're here.
Dan, can I jump in for you?
Yeah.
I mean, kind of dance around a little bit, and everything that Dan said is, as far as I know, completely true. But you know, there are people that own some of these buildings, and there are people who would like to own some of these buildings who have approached the city, as I understand it. They don't approach me, but people keep me somewhat informed sometimes. I think the instinct of the plan department of the city and my very clear direction was that might be great, but we're not doing anything before we have this, right? So I pushed for this, and you all wanted to have this so that we know. We don't want to go ahead. You know, I was sitting out here when the hotel and the parking lot was being proposed, and I had my pitchfork. You know, we're not going to do that again, right? So the reason we're here is specifically to have a conversation, think about what might happen, think about what we might be okay with, what we might not be okay with, and once we get to that point, we might have to dial back. Right? If you're looking at certain sites and different styles, and then you start thinking about the use, maybe the height that we thought about after the last meeting doesn't make as much sense. So, you know, this is an evolving process and an evolving sort of, the thinking evolves. The other thing to think about is the character that we mentioned in Davis Square in terms of the uses, the buildings that are there. You know, if there's something other than affordable housing that I hear the most often, it's we're losing the character of Davis Square, the independent shops that we all love and all that. How do we save that? It's really complicated, but one thing theoretically that we can do with zoning is like we did with the affordable housing amendment that we did this past year was require certain things if developers want to do certain things. So hypothetically speaking, I'm not suggesting this. I'm just saying, you know, for example, perhaps we could say, you know, the zoning is this, but if you want to go up higher and create designated affordable commercial space, maybe that's something we'd be okay with, or not. But that's why I wanted to have these conversations.
The other thing was, at the last meeting, we were asked what type of center most closely reflects Davis Square now. Not which one we want Davis Square to be, but which, and there were conflicting characteristics between the different items. So that didn't mean that we all agreed that this height building was what should be in Davis Square. And my question is this a done deal that this is what the height of building is going to be permissible in Davis Square?
This level, this first column here, or this first row actually, that's four stories, is exactly what Davis Square is zoned to be today. And there's not rampant development happening, right? We live in the existing context of four stories being permitted. 50 feet, and there's not an unending development pressure, and this, so you should think of this as business as usual, although we do put in a couple examples with how to modulate business as usual, but that could be thought of as your starting point.
Okay, but if there was a rezoning,
I mean, that's why we're here asking these questions. Yeah, yeah, this could, if no one votes for any square but this, that's informative, right? If everybody votes for six stories and a step back, that's also informative. That's what the point of the exercise is.
From a process standpoint, when you said, you know, is this a done deal? None of this is a done deal. Even whatever comes out of these meetings isn't a done deal. It'll go into a plan, but then it has to go before the board because we write the zoning. I'm the chair of the land use committee. That's what we do. And none of that happens without additional input. So, you know, what the administration suggests, if we come up with something and we're going to rezone the whole city, or we're looking at potentially doing that, what goes into the Davis Square portion of that, whether it's in the overhaul or separately, I'm not sure where we are on that yet, but that will be informed by these conversations. But then we start, as the board then starts reviewing the zoning, and we continue to hear, and if whatever we didn't get right, and there will be things that are not right, you know, in whatever is proposed, because that's just the nature of things, we're going to continue. So none of this is a done deal by any stretch, okay?
I think the other thing to remember is that the process of, we don't change zoning unless there's, like, affordable housing came up in the community and we changed zoning because of it. The staff doesn't go writing zoning that changes the city anymore. This current staff doesn't write zoning that changes anything in the city without doing planning work first. And this process that we're undertaking with you is going to take time to develop, and you're all going to have an opportunity to review each draft of each chapter and then review the whole document and give us your comments and feedback about it. So this is just one little piece of that longer process, and it'll all feed and answer a lot of questions that we're not talking about today. But today, nothing's being decided today, and nothing's a done deal. There's a lot of work that's still to be done.
So Dan, if we could move to the activity, because I think a lot of the questions still hanging in the room, or some that maybe aren't addressed through this exercise, you have some framing questions, and then there's also a comment area on the board to talk about some of those concerns outside of massing.
So for each site, there's a board that sets up the existing conditions, identifies the site on a map, shows you some information about its size and its street frontage. And then there's a comment section that, you know, we want to know, don't ever develop this site. I love it for the farmer's market or something like that. And that's what that area is for. And then there's some context photos from different angles to try and help you understand the site. The second board is three different heights, 4 stories, 5 stories, and 6 stories. And then the 3 ways to modulate massing, which we talked about. And these are the 3 ways that science found that our brains recognize that this isn't perceived as big as this, although this might not be uncalled for to some of you. So don't feel like the rest of us are keeping you from voting for this. If you like one of these that's straight up and down, because there a lot of the buildings are like that in Davis Square, if you like that, make sure you vote for that. You don't have to pick one of the ways to shape it. But if you think that 6 stories is completely inappropriate, you don't necessarily have to vote for the lower ones. You could, if you think that, you know, stepping back the upper stories makes this appropriate, then you could vote for a 6-story building.
That's slide 8. Don't put that here.
Right. Yeah. So there's no step back above the 4th floor. We illustrated beyond the 4th floor. So this would be there's like no option actually. And then I want you to think about the questions that environmental psychology asks when they do their types of research. Does this building cause too much enclosure? Would this street be dominated by how tall this building is? Is this building too massive? And I want you to also look at the buildings and think about length. Now, remember that we had to take photographs on limited street width, so some of these look long, but that's why you're supposed to ask the question of, does breaking up this mass make it feel not long anymore, right? Third question, does adjusting this mass make the building more appropriate for its context? Another one could be, does this building block too much sunlight, right, at street level? All of those things about how the building impacts the experience of the building and of the street are the types of questions we want you to be thinking about when you're looking at these buildings. And that's it. So we're handing out dots.